Welcome to Keith and the Girl. I'm Keith Malley.
And I'm Libby Phillips.
Kenda's on assignment.
What's her assignment?
You know, honest to God, I never asked.
Yeah.
But it really seems too late. Today's guest from Late Night with Jimmy Fallon, Down and Dirty with Jim Norton, Comedy Underground with Dave Attell. From the album If These Balls Could Talk, which coincided with his Comedy Central Presents Half Hour, Louis Katz.
Thank you. Hey, what's up?
What's going on, buddy?
Not much, man. Happy to be here.
You don't have a tumor or anything, right?
Not that I know of, but I really haven't been checked for full tumors lately.
Yeah, that's how they get you. Yeah. Not that you know of.
Well, Hemda, of course, is in the hospital right now, and you know, I sent her a message. I said, knock him alive.
Thoughts and prayers.
Right? She's having her own kind of Monday night football right now. They said it's a tumor in her that they're taking out today.
Yeah.
The size of a football.
How is that? I was wondering, sorry if you've already discussed this. That's so huge. How do you not notice something like that?
Yeah, Honda, get your shit together.
No, but seriously, what is it? Doesn't it feel like, there's a football?
I'll tell you how. It's squishing up her other junk inside of her. So it's.
Well, you have no nerves inside, though, right? Maybe? So that's why you don't feel it until it's.
I don't know. Do you feel your lungs when they expand and contract? Because her lungs getting like squished up. They're going
to
unfurl it.
I'm trying to think about it now.
They're probably doing it right now.
Man.
It's more a Tom Brady football is what we're hoping. So we'll see. But we'll get to that. Louis Katz, what can I tell you? You're back to America. You were visiting, China?
Yeah, I was in China about a week ago for shows and stuff like that.
With your girlfriend?
Yeah, she's also a comedian. She was doing sets too.
How long has this been going on?
That I had a girlfriend that was in China.
Both.
One's more shocking than the other. I've had a girlfriend about a little over a year now. I've been with her, and we actually we just moved in together. That's pretty crazy.
Whoa, because I'm looking here when you were on March 6, 2014.
Is that the last time I was on? Has it been that long?
It's been that long.
Wow.
The episode 1936, if people want to look it up, called Cats and Dogs. Very clever. and I'm hearing Space Jam. Louis and his girlfriend at the time lived together for a month while she was in between apartments, and Louis did not enjoy it because he needs his space.
Oh, shit. Man. This bodes well.
Oh, no.
Look at you.
Well, that...
How long were you two together?
It sucks for my ex to hear that now I have found someone whose space I can share.
It is funny. I love it. Yeah.
How long were you with that girlfriend before you moved in?
That was just for a month, and we were together probably a little... over a year.
So nothing alike, this relationship.
Well, you know what's kind of interesting is that I thought they're different for sure, but then I kind of what being with her made me realize that a lot of the problems are my own problems.
Right.
So now I've learned that I have these problems and I'm just used to it. And maybe if I'm feeling that that claustrophobic, it's not about even her habits. It might just be me, you know?
But isn't it always funny for the ex now? Being like, oh, I'm glad you figured it out. Why wouldn't you figure it out and call me back? But okay, you guys figured it out. Fantastic. Do you keep in touch with exes?
No, she's not happy
returning calls
with me. And no, actually, we were kind of in touch for a while, but it just wasn't good. It was like, it was too much. I don't think either of us was really ready for it, and it would just get... weird when I'd be out with the new one and the old one would text, and it was just like, this is too much.
Was she a comedian also? Yeah.
She was not a comedian. No, she was not. This is my first time ever dating a comedian.
Oh,
I tried to
congrats.
Avoid it. I don't know if congrats is in order. I was really trying to avoid it if at all possible.
I'm sure your current girlfriend will be happy to hear that.
She knows. She knows that. I mean, for good reason. I mean, I don't know. It's, you know.
I'm sure she was trying to avoid the same thing.
I don't know about that.
Oh, no?
Does the current not let you talk to exes?
She doesn't. She's cool with all of it, but she was a little bit like, she likes to know. She likes to be very honest, maybe too honest, I would say. And so I have to tell. I don't have to tell her anything.
Right.
But she'll ask me, have you talked to this one? Have you talked to that one? And I'll tell her if I've reached out to any of them.
Right.
She's usually pretty chill.
Okay.
With whatever.
Like if you said, tonight my ex is in town, I'd like to hang out. Would she have a problem with it?
I don't think she'd have a problem with that.
Okay.
No. I mean, depends. Yeah, it depends which one.
Ha.
The horny
that's
one.
That's fair.
It's always the horny one.
Let me talk. I do want to talk. Well, I want to talk about China and how you're a sexual freak. But your podcast, the Louis Katz podcast.
I canceled it.
I've been following. I think this is so funny.
Bad ratings?
Yeah, I canceled it for bad ratings.
So he does this podcast. Tell me if I'm remembering correctly.
Uh-huh.
And you'll begin it like, hey, I don't even know why I'm fucking here.
Yeah.
Everybody I know seems to have a podcast. I guess I have to have one.
That's a typical intro. Yeah, that sounds about right. Oh, you listen. That's great.
Yeah. I don't have any. I'm not even going to bother with an agenda because who gives a shit? And yep. Thanks for spending an hour with me.
Yes. Yes.
And then you tell people, hey, look, it doesn't look like a lot of people are listening to this show that I don't give a fuck about.
Yes.
I'm going to cancel it.
Yes.
People write you and say, why'd you cancel it? I liked it. And Louis writes back, well, too late now. I didn't know.
Well, it is. All right. In my there's a couple things in my defense.
You have to build
First
things
of all,
up.
Some people said they really enjoyed the hateful sarcasm of the opening. Some people hated it. I will say, some people hated it. Some people liked it. Some people enjoyed that I was like, fuck this, and I was so hateful.
Right. I do not respect your time.
Well, I'd be like, and here's a droning sound for 50 minutes. You know, it's like the intros were me bitching, and then it would be a more than decent conversation most right. of the time, you know, and a good podcast. But what I didn't realize was that people don't necessarily listen. People, it's like just that time is so not linear when it comes to internet stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So literally, after I canceled it, since then, I was like, I'll hear from it in a week because I'm like busting my ass to get it out on time every week.
Right.
I'll be like, well, if anyone's listening, they'll be so pissed off if there's not a new episode in the week that I'll hear from them and then I'll have to keep going. And right. I didn't. But then over the months since then, because people don't necessarily listen like that,
right.
I've gotten not a ton of complaints, but definitely people have complained. People have been like, oh, I used to listen to the podcast. So it is kind of a bummer that I didn't realize it right away. But I do think that you're right, what you said, not about me hating it, because I feel like I'm right to hate it, but I feel like the lack of an agenda is the problem. I think, you know, you guys are so skilled at what you do, and you did it for so long and stuff like that.
Thank
but for
you.
Me to just for me to just for me to just come along, I just think to have another podcast that's just personality driven without some kind of a topic or kind of an agenda right. is. I think I'm a little late to the game for that, and I just feel like it's not. I feel like it was something. I think I was actually good at it, but I don't think it's the thing I'm best at, and I just can't. I just run out of time to do things. You know what I mean? It's like right. if I'm gonna do this. Or am I going to write? I mean, I already feel like stand-up is one job.
Yeah. Right?
And then whatever the other thing is, whether it's writing scripts or mm-hmm. podcasting, whatever, is like the second job. And this is me doing it full-time. And plus, I'm on rep right now, so I'm booking myself. So it's like I'm doing all the managing agent stuff.
Mm-hmm.
I'm doing stand-up and then whatever else I'm going to do. And I try to do podcasting and that. It just was I was too crazy with the time and stuff like that.
How long did you do the podcast for?
A little over a year.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
That's good.
And... No, I've heard you got to do it at least 2 years, and I just was like, fuck it. But if I came up with a concept that I could do on a regular basis, something with more of a concept right. to it, I would be open to do it again. I haven't sold the equipment; still have all the equipment. But did you think it was like, is it kind of insulting the way I went about it? Kind of.
It didn't sound like you respected your audience or their time.
I don't know if that's true. I could get how you'd get that vibe.
Right. It seemed a little like, I don't know, don't do us any favors, do a podcast, and then you're like, oh, now that it's over, you want the podcast. I see how it is. But like you said, people binge listen just like they will binge on Netflix. Like, I'm a podcast listener, and I'll listen to 10 in a row.
Yeah, sure.
So I might easily be a month behind.
Or there's some things that people listen to like on a very weekly, daily basis. Some mm-hmm. things people are like, I haven't caught up in this in a while, and they'll hit it up. But yeah. I don't know. I mean, I really put in, as much as I was complaining about it, I put a lot of time into it. I would put more time into it than I probably. I mean, it wasn't slapdash. I think the sound was pretty good. I make sure it was all. I mean, people don't even. I mean, you've heard other people's stuff.
Sure.
I mean, you guys run such a professional thing here, but it's like it's not always equalized.
Oh,
it's,
they're awful.
Yeah, they sound like shit. They're not equalized. The time, you know, the sound is all over the place.
They answer the mail and keep the sound going.
Yeah.
No exaggeration. Yeah. All right. But you don't miss it, it sounds like. So who cares?
Yeah.
No, I'm always just trying to do so many. I never have enough time. It's like, it's such a weird thing with this comedy stuff where it's like, I just feel like as much as I should have all this more free time, right. I feel like I wake up in the morning and I just work till I go to sleep, basically. Because mm-hmm. I'm working for myself, and it's fun. It's all comedy right. and stand-up, but it's like, it's just like, I just cannot, I'm like, even when I do, like, put as much time as possible in, I still do not have enough time to do everything I need to do.
How long were you in China, did you say?
I was there six or seven days.
Six or seven days,
I think.
With the girlfriend, obviously, you're yes. staying in what, a hotel?
We're staying in various hotels. It was really intense. It was 6 days, 7 shows, 5 cities, and that was a lot. And I've never, I travel all the time, and I even for not for stand-up, but I try and get out of the country as often as possible, at least once a year. And this was like one of the most intense trips I've ever done.
How so?
Just because I never, even when I've done shows internationally, places where I want to see the cities and stuff like that, usually I'm either in one city so I can go out, sleep the amount I need to sleep, and then go see one thing maybe in the afternoon. And I'll be there for a few days so I can see like one tiny thing, and then the next day I can see another thing, you know, like that. Or I'll just wait till after all the touring, and then I'll stay a little bit extra, and then I'll see some stuff. But this was trying to push it all into the same time as I'm doing the shows, and I'm doing the tourist thing, and I'm going from city to city, which is always tedious when you're touring. It's just like, that takes up so much of your time. Plus, the jet lag was crazy.
How many cities did you do?
We did five cities.
Now, when you say we, is your girlfriend performing also?
Yeah, she's performing too, but she's doing like 10 minutes. I'm doing like an hour. And
does she open for you?
Yes.
She has to, right? You can't pick somebody else, can you?
What do you mean?
Your girlfriend's a comic. You're traveling with her. Could you say, just for this, the vibe's better with my friend Bob?
I could say that. Well, the thing is that Bob won't let me fuck him. So not that she's not funny or whatever. It's like, it's just like, it's about a companionship thing. I would always rather be on the road with a friend or a girlfriend, either way. And with her, it's just even more fun. I mean, it's like not just fun. It's like mentally stabilizing. It's like, it can be so depressing and weird on the road that it's so good to have her with me. Like, just improves the quality of life by so much, you know.
Do you guys go on the road together often then?
Yeah, we've done. She was. It was long distance for a while. She was based in New Orleans, so then I would go down there and I do. There's no club in New Orleans, so I'd do one nighters based out from there. So like all around there, like a couple hours out, I did like every little show anywhere near there, so I could stay with her and then still do shows out there. And then we did a cross country tour over the summer, which was great.
Driving,
yeah, driving. We did. It was so stupid. She was moving to New York, so we decided to do a cross country tour to the West Coast with her car, which was really dumb. Right. And the car's still on the West Coast. Actually, the car is still in Los Angeles at my parents' house. It was like not planned well, but it was and it was kind of rough with the shows. It's like, it's very hard these days. It's like to book these, because I'm booking these weird one night gigs, kind of where I go outside of the clubs. I'm doing like an independent music club or venue,
right?
And I have local comedians usually book it and set it up for me. And it's really hard to organize, and it's especially harder to do because they respect my credits more than a club would. A club would be like, I don't care if you've done these things. We want to go through the agents, or we want someone who can put like a ton of butts in the seats. Okay. So they'll be like very happy to see me, but they're also happy to see like, well, we already booked this crew of open micers from Oklahoma 3 months ago, so I'm sorry you can't do this date. I'm like, really? You can't? Why don't they just... Wouldn't you rather have me there? So that one was kind of hard to put together because I think a lot of people are trying to do what I did over the summer.
Right.
And usually, you know, so it just takes so much planning. It's nuts. Every different city is a different contact.
But the two of you survived a cross-country trip. That's a big test, right? Now,
I'd say we're better traveling than we are when we're in the same city. It's very odd. I think it's the fact that we always have something like a mission, you know, like something to we're working towards this. We got to get there. We got to do this. Right. We got to do whatever. There's no,
you
like,
get the gas. I'll get the Twizzler.
Break.
Right.
Yeah.
But at home.
And at home, it's like, it's more of a, there's not a constantly switching thing to keep it like, keep it fresh and new and move on that thing. And also it's like, we have to divide our time between so many different things. When we're on the road, it's like, I mean, I really like spending time with her. It's with her, it's not really like ever too much time. We really could spend tons of time together. So at home, it's almost like harder to find time to be together because we do different things, you know?
And you moved in already? Sorry.
Yeah. 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 We moved in. It's been a little tough though, because my apartment, the way it's set up, it's, I would describe it as almost like two studio apartments with a shared kitchen and bathroom. There's no real common area. So that was fine to have a studio apartment by myself. It's a little, and that's the other thing, it's a little harder with her in this apartment because it is a studio without, there's like nowhere to like, like at least at a hotel, there's a lobby, you know what I mean? My building does not have a lobby. There is no other place to be. And we've been kind of sometimes having a roommate and sometimes not, like subletting for a little bit, the other bedroom, trying to slowly convert it into actually a living room for us.
Right. Mm-hmm.
But it's just harder when it's in. We have, most of the time we've been there, we've had a separate roommate. So it's just been like stuck in the studio and us together. So that can even be tougher, I'd say, than the road.
Have you had a live-in girlfriend before?
No. This is the first time. It's kind of crazy to me. It's a little bit nuts.
Is it a big adjustment, or since you guys travel together so much, like you're in each other's personal space a lot, I would think.
We kind of tested out a lot of times. Like, even when I went to New Orleans, I was there for like 6 weeks living with her. So there was that already, and we travel a lot together and stuff like that. And also, I'm just like you, as you quoted, I guess I wasn't as happy with my ex, and maybe that was things with her. But it's also like I'm a little bit chiller with things now, you know. And
For example, what was something that used to bother you that now you're like, maybe that's on me?
I mean, my ex was like we had issues related to sleep, and that's like that's the main thing. My ex would wake up way earlier than me in the morning and just start talking. Just start talking to me. I'm fucking asleep. Like,
did she have like a 9-to-5?
Yeah, but she would do that on the weekends too. It was just like it was just ridiculous. I mean,
and then would you be accountable for things that you said?
Well, yeah. I mean, it's not like I'm dream sleep. I wish I was still able to be unconscious and talk to her, because that would be great. Because I'd still be asleep, but I would be up.
Everybody would be happy.
And then she's like, and she even, I remember this, did you remind me of this? This was something, I think I tweeted this, because this really happened. She's like, she wakes me up, she goes like, why aren't we talking as much? I'm like, I'm sleeping. That's why we're not talking. I'm asleep.
It's been 8 hours, Louis.
But was it a thing where you guys weren't seeing each other? Because you're a comedian, you probably keep late hours. Maybe you're coming home from the cellar at like 3 a.m.
Oh,
was
yeah,
it
man.
Like
I was
two
like,
ships in the night?
I was just, it was like, she was, the thing with her was, and she unfortunately took the brunt of this, but she was my first girlfriend that I had in the same city as me in over a decade.
Oh, wow.
And so I was not used to having a girlfriend and dividing my time. Even long distance is easier for a stand-up. To especially someone who has a regular 9-to-5 and me doing stand-up, I was very much like, I have to do the stand-up. I'm not going to, you know, like, I will be there for you, but I cannot compromise this thing that I'm doing. And I just, she was actually, in retrospect, very, as understanding as you could hope. You know what I mean? I mean, she was very understanding for the most part of it. Completely, actually, but I was just still like kind of like this is. I would still be annoyed by any kind of infringement on it. Mm-hmm. So in retrospect, she was actually cool, but I was kind of a dick about it. Not a dick about it, but I was like less understanding than I could have been. And like she really gave me a lot of leeway to do what I had to do.
If you see her,
I'm glad we solved that. You should send this to her.
Right. If you see her on Facebook and it's her birthday, that pops up. Do you say happy birthday?
I will say happy birthday to her. She did not say happy birthday to me. I just had my birthday was just last week. I flew back on my birthday, which is intense. It was the longest birthday of my life, literally, because of the time difference. Not in a good way. Not in any kind of fun way. Just very long and tedious. But and my girlfriend asked me, she's like, any exes text you? And I was like, oh, very. Some of them really did not. It stood out more the ones that didn't. I mean, there was the two that did were probably the ones I ended on the best terms with, and the longest to go. And the more recent ones that I saw were just didn't nothing.
And you know they got reminded. It's not.
Yeah, totally. Yeah. I mean, she's like this ex that I'm talking about, who I live with for the month, has kind of tried to erase. She told me once when we were talking since we broke up, she's like, I just describe you as some guy I used to hang out with. I'm like, that's a low blow.
Yeah,
I mean,
right?
Come on, that's crazy.
I saw the Facebook birthday list. I check it every day.
Uh-huh.
And I write, you did it, send. You did it, send. So I'm going through this list, and I come across Rob Rinkle, my army buddy, who died. Mm. And I'm about to hit, you did it automatically. I'm like, you didn't. Like, come on, somebody can be on top of this.
So close.
Do you erase people from your phone or anything like that?
No, not like, how do you mean? Not
if they've died.
Oh, no, but on like Facebook, how do I erase them, you know?
You could unfriend them.
I just unfriend them? That seems harsh.
Well, the thing is also people's relatives start running the sites, and then if you send the messages, it weirds them out. It's like it's ghost messages. It weirds people out.
Right.
So you shouldn't do that.
Now, when it comes to my actual phone, I should delete numbers. Like if I get into a big beef with somebody, and I don't know why I don't.
Oh, I don't like to. First of all, I don't delete anything. I love that I have everyone's number, and also like,
but
there's
might,
just memories in there.
But if you do a mass party invite, you don't think you're gonna invite some weirdo?
I'm not inviting everyone in my phone. Never.
I've broke one phone, but it was since they've had Google Contacts, and I've had this, and I've never lost a phone, so I have the same contacts for however long I've had a phone, about 15 years.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so I have everyone's in there. Everyone I've met.
You've never
forever.
Lost a phone, you said.
I've broken ice. I had an incident with a phone on New Year's Day this year that was that caused to the caused the loss of a phone for the first time ever.
That's pretty good. Yeah. I know people losing 15, 16 phones out here.
Oh, really?
What's an incident?
Well,
I mean, I can guess if it's New Year's, right?
Yeah. Well, no. It wasn't even fun like that. It was like I'm lying in bed and I have my I had a thumb code, like a fingerprint code, and I do it mm-hmm. and I do it and I do it. And if you don't do enough time, it's like enter your number.
Right.
And I enter the number, and it's not the right number. I'm like, oh, I have so many numbers. So I enter it again. And then they're finally like, if you enter it one more time, your phone's going to be wiped. I'm like, well, I'm like, okay, I won't do it. I go to like my computer. I reset it from there.
Right.
I'm sending messages to it. So I'm like, oh, it's connecting to it. So I'm like, all right, I'll enter the code now. Entered the code. Phone turns off, turns on, wiped. I'm like, all right, that's okay. Not a big deal. Right. I have an SD card in there. I'm going to go eat some food, chill out, come back. I'm like, everything's going to be on the SD card, so it's not really a big deal. I checked the SD card, and that was wiped too. And then there's only one thing to do at that point, which is
cry,
throw it at the wall. So I threw it at the wall.
You've earned it at that point.
Which I honestly do not regret doing. It felt really good to throw my phone at the wall. I threw it really hard, and it fucking broke, and it was tremendous. But that started like a month-long saga of replacing this phone. It was like it was so fucked up. I went to Chinatown and then got it just the screen. It was like the LCD was fixed. So the guy fixes it for $60. It starts breaking again in the middle of my a tour down south. So I cannot go back to China. Like it's just a dude just an old Asian dude in a shack, basically. Who
so long story short, this is why you went to actual China.
Did you ever find out revenge. What malfunctioned? Like,
no,
why?
That's not malfunction. That's what it does.
Yeah, but
it wipes your whole. If you can't, it's for if someone steals your phone.
No, I know. But did you not have the right code, or why did it end up? It sounded like it went rogue and
I don't
wiped
know.
It after
I mean,
you put the code
in. I guess there's a chance that I mean. You know how it is, especially when it's like those four number codes. Like those, I don't have that many of those. Mm-hmm. I have a bunch of different internet things that are like all these ones. But it was like a.
And
four.
And what are yours?
let me start with my social security.
it's my last four. I'll tell you that much. All right. So here's what I was alluding to when I say about you being a sexual freak. You tell me if you agree or not.
Okay.
First of all, you like larger women because they're very soft, and it's almost like they have titties all over their body. But I look at your girlfriend, and she's not a larger woman.
She's not large.
Is she insecure about that?
She's very insecure because
you keep feeding her.
Well, she's got a little
squeezing.
She's got a little nice thickness when it comes to like thighs and hips and stuff like that. So
good
I'll say
her.
That.
Okay.
But first of all, that's a quote from a joke, which is it's a little bit exaggerated. I kind of like voluptuous women. I have a friend who likes really large women, and I almost feel bad that I took. His prep because he likes, like he's like circus style, so I'm not nearly. I mean, not an exaggeration. Like literally, like huge, 600 pounds, stuff like that. Yeah, so I'm not even like that at all. I just like a thicker or kind of voluptuous woman. But what makes her more insecure is that all the last few women I've dated are black, and that's what she's insecure about. If you had to know what really what freaks her out.
Has she tried blackface? Like in the privacy of your home.
Yeah, yeah. We do a lot. We like to do a lot of dress up, a lot of race play.
Why is she insecure about that?
Because she is not black. And
it does make sense. If it looks like you have a type, I'm obviously not your type.
Yes.
But were you ever like, I'm going to go out with you even though you're white? Like, why?
I'm like, I'll do you a favor.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
Congratulations. No, but I do. I can see why. She knows I'm attracted to that. But what she's also found is that and I'm kind of odd like this where I legitimately don't have a type. I kind of have, I like date one girl and then I start liking the type that I'm dating.
Right.
Like, especially also with porn and stuff like that. Like, I'll be looking for girls and I check out girls that look kind of like the girl that I'm with, actually,
funny.
Which is weird.
My type is if you like me.
Yeah. but I really, I mean, she is part of my type, to be honest. Like, I don't, right. She falls in the range. I like brunettes. There's very few things I don't like. I have to be more specific about, it's easier to list what I don't like than what I like.
Okay. What turns you off?
It's blondes, which is weird.
Yeah.
I'm not, if a blonde is attractive, then she's attractive and I'm into it. But typically, I even have a problem recognizing blondes, like telling them apart. It's fucked up. In the industry, it's horrible. There's a lot of blonde women who work in the industry, and they're very important. And I'm just like, who? I don't know who you are. I'm sorry. And it's just so blondes is not my thing. Like you said, skinny, very skinny is not necessarily my thing. But right. I like very tall, very short, brunettes, voluptuous.
Did you ever notice your girlfriend now try to speak Ebonics?
Only during race play. Okay. It's like that's for blackface time only, I would say.
Now, when we talk about the podcast that you did, because you see all these other comedians are doing podcasts, almost feels like you have to do one. Do we have to worry that all your friends are getting married? Do you feel like you have to get married that simply because of time?
I would say less married and more like more kids. I'd say kids is more the issue than married because of this.
Is that from your parents sort of thing? Or no, it's are your from, friends all I having
think,
kids?
I think... there's literally a finite amount of time. Sperm is tarting up in my balls. Right. I want a high quality kid. You know,
you want kids?
I thought I did. And what's crazy is she doesn't. Mm. So I'm really into her. And she doesn't.
My lord.
I'll tell you the goofy part of all this. She doesn't.
No. But here's what I didn't emphasize was not only is she the first white girl I've dated in forever, the second white girl I've ever dated. Okay. She's the only Jew I've ever dated. So that's what I meant when I said it's kind of funny how she doesn't. Because it's like I'm finally dating another Jew. The whole point of that would be to create more Jews. And she's like, I don't want to make more Jews. And I'm like, well, I guess we're not making any more Jews. I don't know what to tell you.
And you're okay with that?
You know,
can trick her later.
I mean, she's young enough that, and I never want to assume it. I think it's wrong to assume. Like they always go like, oh, women will change their mind when they get older. Mm-hmm. Like, I'm not going to assume that. Maybe right. She won't change her mind.
How old is she?
She's 28. So okay. I think but that being said, there is time for her to change her mind. Like usually they say it's like kind of early 30s, mid 30s right. kind of thing. Maybe she will, maybe she won't. The more I see my friends with kids, I'm like, maybe I don't want kids. I don't know. It just seems like a real
work.
Yeah, not just
did
work,
you ever babysit younger siblings? What's your experience with kids?
I mean, I was a camp counselor and I was a substitute teacher, so okay. I've done more of I've done, and I consider both those babysitting more than anything
that's
else. But
experience.
But I don't really like. She's funny because she thinks babies are so cute and interesting, and I find mm-hmm. babies to be incredibly dull and not actually that cute. They're not that cute. They're kind of boring. They don't really do anything. I think it's cool when you can start talking to them and communicate with right. a kid, and mm-hmm. that I think is really cool. And
there's
I like
a ways
kids.
To get there, though. You got to get through those first couple of years first.
Isn't it weird when a parent says, oh, I've learned so much from my kid? And you're like, you must be dumb. They're so dumb. What could you possibly be learning? Blocks? That's crazy.
ABCs.
Right. You like to smell things that shouldn't be smelled.
That's true.
Now, I was talking about this the other day.
Yeah.
That I walked past... a homeless person.
Yes.
I take a whiff. Yeah. I want to see what level we're on. Are you like that?
Yeah, that's you quoted a bit, and that's the next part of that bit about how how first I'll smell it, and then I'll hold my breath, and I'm like, ugh, and then I'll take another sniff just to Ooh. See where it's at. You know what yeah. I mean? Also, to see how powerful it is. Like how far? mm-hmm. What's the range on this smell? You know what I mean? How far does it go? How powerful is it?
I try to guess what body part has gangrene.
In New York City, that's a dangerous game that you're doing.
Well, I wanted to, I pitched the show around called I Smell New York, where I would go around and smell things and talk about the smells, but no one wanted to buy it.
We need smell-o-vision first. You're ahead of your time.
Right, well, right. To me, that's what I really like. I think it's really cool and funny and kind of, I would say, beautiful when someone can like, a smell is so ephemeral. So like to describe mm-hmm. a smell, I always thought it was like really funny the way people use words to describe a smell. It's such a weird concept. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So I think that's kind of cool to like try and describe the scent to people just with words.
Is it me or is this your next podcast idea? Hello.
Smells, I mean, a
Smell-o-vision
smells
with Louis Katz.
You call it Smell You Later.
Maybe that's, I don't know. I've got a lot of concepts for podcasts, but I don't know if I can sustain any of them. I think it's like hard to come up with something that you can really sustainable with a concept. That's also like somewhat easy to produce. Like I said, it's always going to be a side thing, unfortunately, no matter what, because of stand-up.
You're already walking around the city.
Smelling
you take
things.
A recorder instead of a walking tour.
Uh-huh.
It's a smelling tour.
Uh-huh.
You just, you know, yell out a street name every once in a while. You're in business.
And just talk about the smell. Yeah. Well, you know, one thing I
found... Let's say I'm looking for a place to move.
Okay.
And then I go, oh, I'm looking into Union Square.
Uh-huh. And I go smell it?
I load up your episode. of union, and I go, this is a smell. Like,
you take requests.
Yeah, it smells like hippie, but it's clean. You know, you do a kind of description. I go, yeah, that's a place I can live.
Notes of Buddha.
I did want to do that. Like, here's a Chinatown one. Here's a Subway one. There's actually, I think, a perfume factory in Queens that I wanted to go there and talk to, like, smell experts and stuff like that. But I just don't. I mean, that's three episodes. How is this going to go on forever? And plus, you're talking about walking around. Have you ever tried to do a podcast while you're walking around?
No.
I have. It's weird how difficult it is to have this kind of this much of a focused conversation while you're doing even anything else. Mm-hmm. Even just walking around, which should be like you talk to people all the time when you're walking around. But it's a little bit harder for some reason when you're walking or even driving sometimes. I've done the driving one. Sometimes that was okay. Mm-hmm. But still, it's very hard. You have to really concentrate for some
reason.
Even
being on the phone, I can't. Like, there's so much going on when you're walking around on the phone in the city. And,
yeah,
like,
sometimes
you'll, of course, bump into someone or there's, you know, you're yelling at the cab traditionally.
Yeah. going back real quick to the marriage talk.
Yeah.
You mentioned how you don't like it that your friends are getting married because they're turning into pussies. They're always apologizing.
Is that what it says there?
Uh-huh. And you say how, you know, they all get the same beer belly, but it's not from beer, it's from swallowing pride. Do you find yourself now that you can still be yourself and you're not one of these pansies?
I do.
Or do you realize, hey, it's the way things are. It's another person.
Well, I mean, I have my friend who says that fucking happy life, happy wife, quote, happy wife, happy life. Mm-hmm. I mean, that sounds...
That should offend women.
It should offend everybody. It's right. Fucking pathetic. It's a right. Sad way to live. It's a horribly sad way to live. Someone tweeted it. So I think it was Michelle Wolf or someone. She tweeted and I forwarded it to him. Like, she's like, I just like... hate to imagine what kind of a bitch you're living with. Yeah. This is like, how your life works. I mean, it's like, that's not true. If you're happy and they're, you have to both be happy. What the fuck is this? That's
ridiculous.
You shouldn't need
a slogan to describe how happy your marriage is.
Right.
Well, a slogan, how about not a one-sided slogan? I mean, it just seems kind of sad to me. But I do, you know what's actually tough with her is she has, for a while we couldn't talk about things. She's like way feminist, which I'm cool with, but she can't.
Your girlfriend.
Yes, okay. My girlfriend is, and but sometimes it would like she would get so like
heated.
Yeah, like worked heated up. That she couldn't like I'll talk about anything. Right. You know what I mean? But she just couldn't talk about it with me, and it was like
you have to remind her you're on her side.
Yes. Well, it's just. I mean, I get very frustrated when I cannot. I feel like I can't communicate. It's like it must go back. It's like primordial with me. It must be something from preschool. Like I get really frustrated.
Oh, you're one of those weirdos that likes to be heard. Okay.
But when you say not communicate, she wasn't listening or you weren't able to express yourself?
I wasn't able to express myself.
Okay.
And I felt like I was like holding back on things and like I couldn't. And she's gotten way better than that. Way better with that and stuff like that. And also like I've come to realize things where it's like I just can't. Like there are certain things. It's kind of interesting with any kind of issue like that where you're talking about when someone's talking about their issues with their specific group to someone who's not from that group.
Uh-huh.
And when you're from that group, a lot of those issues are attached to all these emotions.
Right.
And it's very hard for the other person outside of that group to feel those emotions, to feel empathy. And the way to feel empathy, I think for me, and I tend to be pretty good at it, is to understand it logically.
Mm-hmm.
If you can explain it to me logically, then I can be like, oh, I could see how you would feel that way. I have to make a logical conclusion in order to get that emotional connection. But that's very hard for someone who's emotionally connected to break down something logically when they just feel that way. Right. So it's necessary to create empathy to explain it logically how you feel that way. But I could see how frustrating it would be to do that. Does that make sense?
It makes sense, but was it something where you couldn't, like, I don't want to say not believe her because I don't think you were saying, like, you're a liar, but you couldn't comprehend, like, things she was telling you because she wasn't explaining it in a logical enough manner for you to get it?
No, I would get, I would.
Because sometimes there's things like, oh, this guy has a creepy vibe. Maybe I don't have a way to describe that. You know, that is a way that you can understand it and like, well, he did this, this, and this. But it's like, I fucking know if a guy has a creepy vibe and I don't want to ride a train alone at night with him, you know? Like,
there's that kind of thing. And then there's also just the fact that she would get so upset with me that I'm like, why can't we talk about this anymore? Mm-hmm. And that's more of a time, more often than not, it would be that she would be so, I would be like, why can't we just have this conversation? Like, why do you have to, like, why are you so, like, why can't we just talk about this?
Mm-hmm.
And she would just get so flustered that she couldn't, you know what I mean?
Because you're removed enough from it to have an impersonal conversation, and to her it's more
Yeah, but I mean, some of it wasn't even like she'd been real crazy with this election, man, and it's like I couldn't talk to her about anything, like anything about that shit, and that was very frustrating.
You're pro Trump, I take it.
All the way. I mean, it's about time we took.
That's going to be a sticking point.
Back. No, she's contrary to most millennials, she was very from the get go, very very pro Hillary, very very anti Bernie, and I was like on the fence about it and stuff like that. But it would get to the point where since even when I was leaning Bernie, I've since come around. Like I think Hillary is the better candidate. I honestly think that now, but it took so long for her to admit. Like, can you at least like admit that there is a she lacks one. She's most prepared, but you know what she lacks? What politicians need? Fucking charisma. Right. She lacks sometimes with the charisma, with the speech thing. And unfortunately, that's part of the job of getting to be president, is you have to get elected. And it's not. And people, I just don't buy that the only reason people hate her is because she's a woman. I don't
buy that.
I definitely, for sure. But to not admit that there is a lack, I mean, she just doesn't have. I mean, shit, like. Watch Obama. She can't. She like Obama is so fucking charismatic. You know what I mean? So it's like, and it's hard to compare it to him. But it's like, I mean, come on. She like, she's, and I understand the reason why and all these things. But and I definitely think there's a lot of misogyny. A lot of the hate on Hillary is totally rooted in misogyny. But you can't say you don't watch her. See, she lacks empathy and charisma. She's bad at those things.
Well, okay. Here's what I'll say is that people who have spoken to her in person and people that she works with. Mm-hmm. Say the exact opposite.
Except for the Secret Service people who say she was crazy mean to her.
Okay. Well,
depending on what you read.
I mean, yes, of course. There's two sides to every story, and no one is perfect 100% of the time. I'm sure some people have some stories about you being an asshole, and same for me.
I am now taking phone calls. Now we're talking.
But it's also, she gets slammed either way, so I have a hard time with the personality thing. She's competent. Like, since when, you know, fucking Bernie was screaming during the debates, Hillary's not allowed to do that, you know?
Yeah, like, sure. Or even look like Bernie looks.
Exactly.
You know,
Bernie
looks like a lunatic. He looks half homeless all the time. You know?
I do want to smell him.
Right. Now, that's a podcast I'd listen to.
Soup and mothballs is what my guess.
How about this? You smell famous people. And you tell us what they smell like.
There was that dude that tried to smell Kim Kardashian's butt, and he got tackled. He got fucked up.
Wow, you should be.
I should be. That's just kind of a dick. It's a dick move.
You got to work up to the butt.
Yeah, man. You got to have permission to smell. You can't just smell someone's butt without permission.
By the way,
PSA from Chloe Katz.
Speaking of smelling, you really love to rub your face on a girl's pussy. The problem is you'll notice after an hour or so, that your face is covered in dry pussy juice.
What, do you fall asleep?
But then you're also super paranoid about STDs.
Yes.
Thanks to abstinence-only sex ed.
Yes.
You get tested all the time, even when you don't have sex.
Yes. I'm a walking contradiction. I'm very much into like weird sex, and I'm also a germaphobe. And that's a conflict of interest right there.
Right.
And it's, I don't know why I have them both, but I have them. I'm both those things, and it's weird. And that's another thing with living with a girl too, is like I've noticed like I'm just. Most girls I've dated, I'm like, and it goes against like typical gender stuff. Is like I'm the cleaner one. Like I'm like crazy with the clean stuff, and it's just like I just can't.
But
like,
you are the cleaner one, because when you were with this woman for a month, you were both slobs.
The one who I lived with before,
yeah.
No, she's fucking filthy. She's fucking filthy, and so is my girlfriend now. Also, kind of filthy. They're both pretty filthy.
Maybe that's your type.
Nah, I mean, I just like girls, but you don't find out till too late that they're filthy. And it's like,
What does she do? Like, that's a pet peeve.
Well, to me, it's just the bed. Besides, sex mess,
right,
is like your clean zone, kind of. You know what I mean? It's like that way I can shower at night if I want to, and get up in the morning, and I'm not fucking gross,
right?
So I'm saying, if you've gone, like, if you've biked and if you've done a bunch of shit all day. Right. Take a fucking shower before you get in bed, you know? Or, you know, this is the big one with me, man, is that another reason, I'm trying to talk about it on stage, and no one knows what the fuck I'm talking about, so maybe it doesn't work.
Okay.
But I think part of another thing that makes women dirty is they don't understand how filthy guys are. Like, this girl's staying in a house, especially when I have another roommate. So there's usually two guys there and one woman. Mm-hmm. they're like walking barefoot in front of the toilet and stuff like that. I'm like, you understand, there's a 6-inch moat of piss that is in front of this toilet here. And it's like, dude, this, my girlfriend, you know what she did on the plane from China? She's wearing socks in the bathroom on a plane, man. Your socks just absorb the piss of 500 Chinese people. It's fucking disgusting. She put her purse down on the floor of a porta potty. That's fucking filthy. Sorry, you just triggered all these things. Now I'm remembering all the things. All those things are just horrific to me. I mean, horrific. A purse on the floor, a porta potty? That's fucking horrible. I would have held her bag. I mean, there's ways around all that. There's ways around. You don't have to be like, you don't have to live this life.
You've earned it.
Respect yourself. Now, what is the sex stuff that you're into that's extra germy, it sounds like? Why are those conflicting?
Ass eating is conflicting. Right. Mm-hmm. I'll try anything, really.
So does it bother you at the time or like it just if you overthink it?
I don't over. It's weird. It does not. It doesn't bother me. I mean, I'm not going to eat a random person's ass. Yeah, we have to be together. I have to know the time from the last shower. I have to know if we're good. If we're good to go.
To be clear, that Kim Kardashian dude was out of line.
Totally out of line. You can't be. Right. You can't be sniffing. You can't go up to a stranger, sniff their ass, man. That's. I mean, I've wanted to, but you don't. You don't do it.
Even if they're a celebrity and it's part of the game.
Okay.
You know, paparazzi ass smelling. You know what I'm talking about. But
if I'm capturing the scent, once they do release smell-o-vision, I'm capturing the scent. A paparazzi for scents. That would be awesome. Like I'm catching the smells of famous people and I'm selling them off to. All right. This is a future.
And then they look down on the ones who just take pictures. They're like, we're next level.
Yeah, yeah. You got to capture their smells.
Now, so instead of just eating the pussy, you really do rub your whole face on it? No exaggeration?
I used to, but this girl that I'm seeing now, my girlfriend now is she
finds it weird.
No, she doesn't like her own taste, you know. It's a problem for me. It's a real problem for me. It limits stuff sexually that she doesn't like.
But you like the taste.
I love the taste. So and I don't and cares? I'll kiss her after she sucks my dick. I don't care. Like that doesn't bother me either.
Well, you don't like to blow yourself, but she can.
First of all, if I could, and second of all, I think it's kind of, I don't know, to me it's kind of hot a little bit. It's like I can. It is gross. I mean, I don't know what this means. I can taste a little bit. I'm like, that's kind of hot. To me, I'm weird. You know, I don't know.
Taste a little bit of yourself.
Yeah.
Have you swallowed your own cum?
Probably. Definitely. I've tasted it. I don't know if I've swallowed it. I don't know if I've swallowed a full load. I have not swallowed a full load. I'll say that.
You gave it a lick.
Sure.
Okay.
Who hasn't?
But the way you said it at first is like, accidentally? I'm sure I have.
I tried it.
If 8 spiders go in your mouth a year.
8 gallons of cum must also.
But you had to have told her, look, I like it. That's the end of the story. Why? I'm not lying to you. Why will you not let me taste you?
No, she'll let me taste her, but it's like, she I'm not trying to like leave it on my face because then I can't kiss her afterwards. So that's the issue there. So that's it really limits things sexually.
Can't you just keep a tissue next to the bed? Just
I'm not trying. I got this beard now. You know what I mean? This shit absorbs all kind of flavors. You know.
Not to
well,
brag.
Supposedly you're so neat. Maybe you just need to be a little neater.
I like keeping it. I wish I could keep it in my beard. I wish I could keep it in my beard all day and just walk around like that. I would love that. I mean, I would just wipe. If I even said to her, I was like, before I go on a long trip next time. I mean, this is nasty.
Wipe it under my nose.
Yeah, let me. I just want to swath on my mustache. I just want to keep that on the plane and just be like there. And I love that I can just be looking at someone.
Right.
Like I'm not. They don't know it, but I know it. I mean, they could probably smell it. You know what I mean? You could smell.
They might be able to tell. It sounds like you're really getting in there.
Yeah, but I mean, to me, that's kind of awesome. I might do that after this trip on Wednesday, or before the trip.
I got a lot of this stuff from If These Balls Could Talk. And so this is in 2011. You also want to sleep with every kind of woman.
Yes.
Now, I'm making a list so far. I have black and Jew.
Yes.
Is this dream over?
I've been with a lot of different kinds of women.
Oh, you have?
Yes. I've, there's some things I haven't done.
Okay.
I mean.
Chinese?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
What do they call it? A fuck it list?
Yeah. Yeah, 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 yeah. Yeah, that's what it's called. That. Yeah, yeah. And okay. I just do like a wide array. It's not like a weird. I mean, I'm just legit attracted to a lot of different women. And I feel like I'm pretty much happy. If I just stayed with her and stayed monogamous, I'd be happy with the women I've slept with, you know, as long as, you know, if there's a wider
You've sowed your wild oats.
I mean, there's always more oats. I mean, I got a lot of oats. But I'm happy with it. And we even talk about, I mean, she's like, you know, she's way into that. And I think it's mostly a trend thing. She's always into, like, talking about, like, she loves the Dan Savage podcast, and she loves to talk about polyamory, which I think is just, I think it's more trendy, and she likes the concept of it.
Mm-hmm.
Then I'm like, well, have you ever tried to be in a polyamorous or open relationship? She's like, well, no. Well, like, well, you know what? You're talking crazy to me. To me, you're talking crazy. Like,
and
I'm sure
you haven't
it works for
either,
some people.
I take it?
I don't, I mean, I've been in open relationships when we weren't really committed, so, but it wasn't, I was never committed to those people the way I'm committed to her.
So you're not interested in an open?
I mean, she's like, it's the way she puts it, like, to some aspect, or with these rules, or things like that, or stuff like that. She said I could probably get a happy ending massage, which is pretty cool. I mean, I think at some point it's going to be like, apparently I have a drive that's more drive than most men, even. And men have, and she's just like, eventually we're just going to have to start hiring hookers for you, which is fine.
How often do you have sex?
I mean, to me, do we have sex, or would I like to have sex?
Do you?
Currently.
Yowzer.
Two or three times a week.
I need more than that. How many times do you masturbate?
Probably every day. I've tried to slow it down to like make my desire match hers a little bit more, but it's still like very hard. She's hard with the timing thing. She has very limited. She has a very narrow window, and it's hard to catch her in that window.
Well, maybe if you'd wake up at 6 a.m. when she's hot and horny,
I would do that. That's not her window. That's not the window.
Do you? What is the window?
The window's the motherfucking afternoon. Who's got time for this? I never heard of
two comics, probably.
Right. Exactly. Sometimes we can work that out. But sometimes I'm like, I'm out. I'm riding. I've got shit to do. Mm. It's like, whoever's sort of not wanting to fuck before you go to bed? I've never heard of that.
Who's ever heard of such a thing?
Have you heard of it? It's the bed. We're in the bedroom. We're in the bed. We just got in the bed. Why would you not fuck then? But she doesn't. That's not her time. That's not the time she likes. She likes the afternoon. Sometimes late at night, but rarely.
Well, maybe if you wouldn't yell at me for having shoes on the bed.
Ugh. Oh, man. If she ever put a fucking shoe. I've got another policy with the bed. It's no street clothes in the bed policy. Okay. Have you heard of this? Other people have this policy.
Yes.
Yeah. See, it's a known policy. It's not. I didn't make it up.
It's known. Keith.
Right, right.
It's a common...
He's not out there on the streets. He's married.
I'm new to the fuck it list, you know? This is what you're dealing with.
The no street clothes policy is just that if any clothes that you wear out and about, especially in this city...
Yeah. It makes sense here.
Yeah, they
other
don't...
places...
Yeah, other places you limit the places where you've touched. You touch maybe your car, you touch your chair at the office, then you're back in your car, and then you're back home. So I get it. But here in New York, you sit on the subway... Your ass has now been on the ass of a million people. You've gone, you know what I mean? You don't know where those people's pants have been. You don't know what was just last sitting in that seat, you know? Yep. And then you can't bring that to the bed. You can't bring that to the bed. And she doesn't even get the street clothes concept. You know what I mean? Like, I'm trying to teach her, but she just doesn't get it. It also seems scummy when I first bring a girl to my room. It's like, you got to take off all your clothes if you're going to be in that bed. You're going to have to do that.
Do you take your phone into your bedroom? Into your bed? Like, do you look at your phone in your bed?
I look at my phone in my bed, but
your phone is filthy!
Not my phone. No. I just...
If it's been in the city, if it's been in your pocket, where is it currently? What is it touching?
It's in my pocket. And you know what happened to it yesterday?
Was there ever money in your pocket?
There is very little money in my pocket, but I only keep it on the backside. I won't let it touch the screen side that touches my face. And then yesterday I went to the gym. You know they have those wipes at the gym?
Uh-huh.
I wipe the phone when I'm there at the gym. And sometimes I'll sanitize my hands and I'll rub it all over the phone. So don't tell me about my phone being filthy. You know what's real nasty? The phone's never on my pillow. It's not touching the bed. I'm holding it. Sometimes she'll have the cord. The cord has definitely been on the ground. The cord will be on the bed. Ugh, it's a nightmare. Fucking cord is so filthy.
Well, congrats to you and your girlfriend.
Thanks.
Best of luck. She puts up
with a lot.
Louis brings up a good point. Think how dirty the outside of a Purell bottle is if every time you grab it, it's because your hands are filthy.
It's true. It's one of the many germaphobe paradoxes that I think about.
Tell me if this is sexy to you. Mm-hmm. Police said a 72-year-old man has admitted to breaking into a woman's home and tainting her orange juice with his body fluid. He jacked off into her orange juice.
All right. Yeah, you have to be more specific. There's many fluids.
Right, right. Do you get it? Or are you like, I get it?
No, man, you can't be jacking off into random people's food, I would say.
Right.
It was saying, if are you saying, are you asking me if there was consent, would I jack off into someone's food?
Would you do it to your girlfriend's orange juice?
Well, we know she would hate that. We've covered this.
She would, yeah, she wouldn't like, if she was into it.
But she wouldn't know.
No, she has to know. Lately, I've been asking.
Well, you buy the pulpy.
What's she going to think? It's a melted creamsicle? She'll know.
I think, no one wants salty orange juice. That's not good.
All right. But you're kind of into it, it seems.
Yeah, it seems kind of hot to me to some extent. See? Sometimes, like on the porn where they're like spitting it out and eating it again and all that, it's like, this is disgusting. That's mm-hmm. that's kind of where I draw. It's like, right. Sometimes that's too much. But I mean, sometimes it's kind of hot. I don't know.
Right.
It's hard to say where I draw the line.
Is are these blowjobs? Like these blowjobs that are in porn now. Is that attractive?
Well, I'm hard right now. So
I'm looking you in the eye.
Well, we found one of your lines.
You're in China, and I see a picture of you eating pork.
Hell yeah!
With a glove.
Oh yeah.
Is this because of Jewish reasons? You can't touch it, but you can eat it?
No, well, it's because of germaphobe reasons. They gave me a bag of pork, but it was tiny, and they didn't even have chopsticks. And I couldn't get to the pork. So I'm like, I go back. I'm just, she didn't speak English. I'm just like, look, I can't get the pork. So they gave me one of their serving gloves.
Right.
So then I was eating pork by the fistful. It was awesome.
And
that
this
was,
is
that was really great.
Street pork?
This was like, it was a nice like jerky shop. Like the first place I went, the first time I went to was actually in the Sichuan, where all the spicy food comes from. Right. So I got to try all the different like spicy foods and stuff like that while I was there. It's almost kind of a bummer, like coming from New York and like LA where I live, because like you travel these foreign countries and typically I have had most of the food that they have there. Sometimes there's some things that I haven't had, but most of it I actually kind of have had. Sometimes it's a better version. There was a better, I'd say the Peking duck I had in Beijing was fucking phenomenal. I've never had that good Peking duck here. And I did have some like Hunan food. I had some dry rub ribs that were like amazing.
Anything super weird, like
dog?
Well, the last time I was there, I've been there before and I did eat dog. I ate dog and rat.
How were they tasty?
They were pretty tasty. What fucked me up was it was kind of like hot pot style. So it's just like a big like cauldron of like sauce and oil.
Okay.
And you just take out like bits. And this is what fucked me up last time I was in China. I didn't find it to be a problem as much this time, was that it's like they just take meat. Like an ant, like a chicken. You know how we'll like debone it,
right?
They just hack it down the line, just like pop, 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 and they just put all the chunks in. So you're always like coming up with like a little bit of bone, a little bit of meat, which is like it just takes, especially and you're doing with chopsticks. This is like taking forever to eat that shit.
Do they eat the bone?
I don't think they eat the bone. It's just like it just takes forever. Right. I don't know. Maybe they do eat the bone because I don't know. I don't know how you can take that long to eat. But I'm eating the dog. I'm eating the rat. And then I reach in the rat pot and I pull out a paw.
No, that was it.
That was where I couldn't turn my stomach because it looks like a tiny hand. It's just a tiny little hand and it's just there on the chopstick. And I'm like, all right, I'm done.
It is funny with pork, he has to have a glove on. Oh, this is the rat pot? All right,
Don't mind if I do.
I'm kind of the same with food as I am with sex. I'll try everything once. You know?
Is shaking hands weird to you?
No. And I feel bad when I tell like germaphobe jokes on stage and I feel like people after the show, like, I don't know, can I shake your hand? I'm like, yeah, you can shake my hand. I'm going to wash it afterwards.
I'm not putting his hand on the bed. I'll tell you that much. I do have a quick update. Hennessy writes, Henda's out.
Yes.
She's out. The tumor came out completely and cleanly, and they didn't have to remove any of her lung. She did really well. You know how you do. I didn't know. I was like, try to do really well and just lay there. You know,
but was she awake?
No.
No. That's what I mean.
Look, I've been in surgery. Like, you did good. Great. What do other people do? Pop a boner? She did really well and breathing just fine. The surgeons are very happy. She is in the ICU now. She will be sleeping for a little while longer. There you go. So this is very good news.
Yay.
That's great. That is great.
If you go on Facebook under Keith and the Girl, you can send her well wishes and understand what's happening. See if they save the football, because I like football.
I was gonna say that they won't let you keep the tumor, right? It's like biohazard, which kind of sucks.
I understand why, because if I was real mad at somebody, I might put something in their orange juice, little piece of tumor. Like if you swallowed a piece of tumor,
do you get tumor?
It can't be good. I'll put it that way. Can't
That's
be
why.
Great news.
That's why, because you're going to feed someone a tumor.
Don't forget keithandthegirl.com/VIP. It's every show we've ever done and all our spinoff shows, including Libby's show where she's been interviewing Hemda about this
reverse what's my name. Yeah, so usually Hamda interviews someone about a topic, and we have been covering the tumor. There's a lot to talk about, so we've done like 5 episodes now.
Man. So take a look right there. And also, I said it was during Mehran that somebody fell off their chair for My Name is Keith. I get the guests drunk and yell questions at them. It's actually in the one that's up right now with Nick Turner. I got him a little confused.
Can I tease one thing about the reverse? What's my name?
Sure.
We get an update about her parents. So check on that if you're interested.
Oh.
That's it. It's a tease, guys.
What happened last night when you...
on
Tumor
Eve.
Tumor Eve, yeah.
Tumor Eve. It was fun. She got a last meal from the diner. Okay. We got a lot of fries, and we were making a lot of sick jokes about when they cut her open, it's like a door because it's in an L shape, and we were like, ask them if it smells like weed.
But like, was there crying? Was she nervous?
Oh, no. Lot of laughing. Lot of good spirits. Good. I think Maricela was worried like she should go to bed. She's like, you should probably rest before the surgery. And we were all kind of like, this is probably just as important that she is like in good spirits. And, you know, we were talking about she's looking forward to the guest hosts and all that sort of thing. So it was very fun. Yeah.
Well, you got Libby co-hosting now, so you're getting a lot of scoops. You know that's her favorite thing. So very exciting. Louis Katz, the Twitter account is at Louis Katz, Louis Katz, KATZ.
That's right.
The website is louiskatzcomedy.com.
Uh-huh.
Like I said, you can check out the album, If These Balls Could Talk.
Yep.
And happy birthday.
Oh, thanks, man. Thank you.
You did it.
Yeah, I'm here.
Yeah, another day. What country's next?
Shit. Sunnyvale, California. Okay. Yeah, I'll be there in the beginning of November. But country-wise, I'm stuck in the States for a while.
All right.
At least through the election.
Well, congrats on your girlfriend.
Thanks.
Congrats on living together.
Thank you.
I hope you can trick her into having children. We'll see. Fingers crossed, you know. They start to leave clocks around. That throws them. They're like, ooh, it is ticking. And that's it. Libby, thank you very much.
Thank you.
And we'll talk to you tomorrow.